got that fixed. That should be online and good to go. Sky. Give me a second, I'm talking to a friend here. Yeah, what's up?
Oh, I'm looking at your stream and a bunch of your videos are, some sections are muted or blinded out for copyright reasons.
Yeah, it's because I play music. That's the way that that crap usually flies. But. So, anyway, so as we were discussing, MGTOW, that turtling and monkey, that's right. My thoughts on that. I thought it was intriguing. I thought, because he made some good points, you know, the way he was talking about the feminism cycle, or what he called the egalitarianism cycle, and that chart he made. I was watching specifically that video, and then I went on and watched a few more that you had sent me, and I thought it was interesting. You know, it was most definitely, he made some very good points. However, there were a few instances where it was, yeah, it's like you said, he kind of hates women, and that's what MGTOW is to me, or what I gathered from that, is that they're basically men who are throwing fits because they're basically no better than feminism. You know, women who are like, oh, well, I hate men because men suck and they do mean things. And then the guys are like, well, we hate women because women suck and women do mean things. And so to me, they're both groups are like whining children.
Well, that could be a fair assessment because, like with any community, there are obviously the toxic and extreme elements that everybody pays attention to versus to where the movement originally was, being a logical and balanced argument versus people going to the extremes and, you know, calling each other out for whining or, not being able to deal with things because, you know, nowadays the phrase used to be is where have all the good men gone? And before that was women complaining that they couldn't find a man who wanted to take care of them because women wanted all the authority with none of the responsibility.
Right.
Now, with MGTOW was, it was made, or it was born, of a retaliation against the system that feminism had built. So, feminism, which at its core seems fair, equal rights for women, you know, so they're treated fairly under law, and, weighed evenly as humans, you know, it's their way of saying, you know, yeah, we are women, but we don't want to be treated as though we're incapable. But now the extreme elements have surfaced and pushed for many more laws that push in favor of, now punishing men. So, for instance, the marriage laws, you know, if a man gets married and then the wife decides to divorce him, whether it doesn't really matter who initiates a divorce, the woman typically walks away with alimony, child support if there's children involved. She'll get the house, she'll get the car, and more than likely get the guy's retirement if he has one. And the only way for that to go away is if that woman who divorced that man gets remarried or dies. Those are the only two ways out, at least for the man. Because even if the man dies, say for instance the man does die, then all that gets paid out of Social Security. The payments don't stop. It doesn't matter who's paying it. They're going to go to the man, but if the man dies or disappears, it defaults to Social Security. That woman's still going to collect some form of alimony and child support.
So right.
That's at least one set of instances where MGTOW's retaliating, because MGTOW at its core is, well, it's an acronym for men going their own way, which at its core is makes sense. It's men refusing to get married, some of them even outright refusing to have any form of relationship with women. It's more of a focus on self-development. Well, it's an acronym because it retaliates against the system that women benefit. The extreme elements have managed to propagandize them and paint them as basically a bunch of whiny basement-dwelling man-children who only play video games, jerk off to porn, and basically ignore growing up. You know, they're perceived as people who don't want to do anything with their lives. But the reality is that MGTOW at its core is largely self-development focused. So it's men focusing on their own health and well-being, focusing on their careers, pushing themselves up the chain, and basically ignoring all the negative elements associated with women. They will refuse to get married. Now, some of them may have relationships with women, but that's perceived to still be dangerous because of the flagrant rape accusations. Though, unless we get into statistics, false rape accusations are rare, but when they do happen, they're easily disprovable. But that still goes on your record. That goes on your record saying you were accused of rape, even if it was disproven. And that can ruin potential employment.
Right.
So MGTOW at its core seems like, it, to me, is honorable intentions. And you have guys like Turd Flinging Monkey who, they bring the science to it. You know, they prove their points and they have the support, but they can get fairly vitriolic when it comes to their criticisms. They speak down of women in general. Like, not all women. And even in one of his videos, he actually admitted that it is possible to have a relationship, but you can't do it the old way anymore, where, you know, you get together and you decide to move your lives forward. It has to be a relationship built on understanding. You know, you have to understand who you are. You have to understand your biology and why things happen. And then you come to an agreement saying, yes, we will work together. We will move forward. Because that's what relationships are about. It's about being together, moving your lives forward, and mutual relationships are supposed to be mutual, based on compromise, because you can't find everybody to be perfect. And so it is possible, but with the urging of extremist feminism, and the feminists out there, you know, obviously it's not who's speaking, it's who's speaking more loudly than everybody else that stands up, thus the extreme element, pushing to say that we are women, we are capable, but you need to foot the bill.
Right.
And, you know, just the divorce laws are one obvious instance of, you know, feminism turning out the way it did. It punishes men for having relationships with women, and if that woman gets bored, that guy pays for her boredom, quite literally.
Well, and I can understand how marriage is one-sided. Because it is one-sided, you know. If you get divorced, the man gets screwed. The man does get screwed. But there's not many instances outside of that where women can say, screw, you know, just, like, fuck up with a man. And there are some instances where, yes, they do get precedence over a lot of things you say. But, say, for example, he kept bringing up the abortion issue and how women can abort a child. Well, here's the thing, is that it's the woman's body. And I know that, you know, because you're not the one who has to carry the child. Now, it would be a different story entirely if he did make one point, and that was that, you know, you would have to, like, if you go and you fuck some bitch, you would have to prove, if she decided to accuse you of rape, you would have to prove that she gave consent. And the problem is that you would have to prove also that at no time did she tell you no or tell you to stop. And in order to do that, you would have to film it. And filming it would be filming a porno, which if you're not a porno studio, is illegal. So, and in circumstances like that, you're entirely right. You're definitely right. Like, we get the downside on that. But it's less about what they do as society, and it's like, how did he put it? Egalitarianism is the way the society is headed. And I remember there was a point he brought up that was something along the lines of women take no responsibility but want all the authority. And an example he had was that women in the first wave of feminism way back in the 40s, 50s, you know, whenever that was, I don't know dates offhand, but, you know, during that first wave feminism, they were talking about, you know, getting women responsible, and they were going to move them up, and they were going to basically make all the laws gender neutral, so that women are subjected to the same group of laws that men are subjected to. And, of course, the draft came up, and the lady who was front-running for that dropped it. She was like, no, I don't want this passed. And all the feminists stopped passing that because it would have made them have to sign up for the draft, and it would have made them have to, you know, they would be subjected to the same crap we're subjected to. Now, in the same degree, there's, recently, one was passed where, a law for the defense was passed, recently. I want to say 2 or 3 days ago, where they were, the law rewritten for the Secretary of Defense, the defense area, had specifically stated in it that they planned to, change the wording of the draft law so that women were also included in the draft. Which is already a different step compared to what they usually, you know, what he was talking about. Because he was talking about how they don't accept responsibility. And it's at a position where they're being forced to accept responsibility. So, I mean, regarding that cycle that he kept talking about, I feel like it's going to be a little bit of a different motion. You know what I mean?
Maybe. In his egalitarian cycle that he pointed out, and it goes typically from, at least if I remember the chart correctly, it goes from a patriarchy where the men are in charge, the men do everything, and the women are typically, at least in history, are subjugated. They're basically breeding factories. You know, they pump out children. But in that system, they are still taken care of. And it typically results in, you know, like one man having multiple women. You may or may not have heard of the 80-20 rule, where 80% of the women are trying to have sex with 20% of the men. So that excludes 80% of the men from, you know, the other 80% of the women. From the rest of the women, there's only the other 20%. And while it may seem great to some people, it's extremely bad because it leads to genetic stagnation and it results in a lot of infighting, which ultimately stagnates any breeding altogether and can lead to the destruction of, you know, a civilization if the people are not breeding with each other and sticking to the 80-20 rule.
Right.
So, in a patriarchal system, that can happen. So, they create what's called the hypergamous nature, or the hypergamous system, where, you know, now it results in pair bonding. Women don't select really the genetically most fit men, they just pick whatever men's willing to take care of them. So it pushes men up in terms of responsibility, and I would say it almost takes away from their authority.
Why would you say it takes away from that authority?
Because in this hypergamous system where it's one man, one woman, the women will typically get more power because now everything is becoming more equal. One man, one woman, it's now spreading out the breeding, and in this system, it typically results in women staying home. You know, they stay with the children, they take care of the home, and then go out and they hunt, and or they gather the resources, rather, to bring back home to thus support the wife and the child. Now, as society evolves and moves forward, these women will begin to demand more. It's in their nature, all right? They want more. It's human nature to want more. So they'll start pushing, they'll start gathering, and demanding more, hence why you have the feminism movements, where women get together, and one got the wise idea that, you know, that being a housewife is now, you know, it's beneath them. They think they should have more. So thus feminism comes along, they get together, they start demanding the right to vote, you know, maternity leave, exemption from the draft. So they want all the authority, but none of the responsibility, because who's going to pay for all this, for all the stuff they're getting? Typically the men. Men are the biggest tax base. They work, they're the ones who pay the taxes. So men are paying for the women to benefit. But the only way to do that is to take from them, whether they're willing or not. So that's when the egalitarian cycle goes from patriarchy to the egalitarian, where women begin to demand equal rights, but then it starts to spill overboard to where they want more rights than men. They want more than what can be provided, so it pushes it down to the matriarchy cycle, part of the cycle, where the women are in charge and the men are subjugated.
Right.
So when the men are subjugated, the obvious reaction is to stop participating in the system. That's the most obvious and straightforward reaction you can have. So that's what MGTOW is doing right now, is it's basically pulling out of the system. So, and I made this argument a while ago, is that if men pull out of the system, because obviously there's the piss poor marriage rate in the United States, where it's now over 50%, I'm not certain about how much, I think it's pushing close to 60% now, divorce rate, and there's fewer people are getting married, that's a problem. Because now with feminism pushing and saying that women have more freedom, you know, the freedom to do what they want when they want without being criticized, you know, obviously you have the guy, the stereotype that if the guy who sleeps around is the fucking playa and the woman who sleeps around is a slut, they want to eliminate that. They want
right.
women to be able to do the same things as men. And they can, that's fine, but at least as far as studies have shown, and they're out there, there's Pew studies and polls that show that women who do what men do, and even for men who sleep around, tend to suffer a lot of unhappiness. They are not happy, they're in fact very miserable, but they keep pushing for it. They tell them, that's what you want, because feminism has now begun to do the critical thinking for the woman instead of the man. Or, I'm sorry, not the man, instead of a woman thinking for herself. And, you know, letting her feelings get her way, rather than letting somebody else tell her what to do.
Right.
So, with men pulling out of the system and not getting married and not subjugating themselves to the system, where it's a bum deal, it really is. You know, who wants to work their entire life to gather, you know, nice stuff, have money to go out and earn their way, and then they fall in love, they marry this woman who then acts on her own nature or acts on what other people tell her to do, and she can then divorce him for any reason, any really given reason, and take all his shit, and there's nothing he can do. There's literally, quite literally nothing he can do because the law is on the woman's side. If he does anything, then it's the fallacy of, you know, he is this, therefore that.
But that same thing applies to women, too, you know, because a lot of feminists make the whole every man is a rapist argument, And the same thing can apply to women, because, as you stated, women have a higher tendency to cheat. So you can say that every woman is also a cheater. Every woman is cheating on her man. And it's all about potential. You know what I mean? And that's not something that's strictly on a man. That's something that also falls to a woman.
When it comes to that argument, you're counting on the, people being logical. And this is, and the exact problem is people are not being logical. They've quit thinking. They quit being logical. They started thinking with their dicks. You know, it was right around when Kansas got started. I forget exactly when. But a study was mentioned an instance in history where in Kansas, it was during the Gold Rush era. At the time, the population of Kansas was roughly 6,000 men to 1,000 women. So a 6-to-1 ratio of man to woman. And these women were, indoctrinated by the feminist movement and wanted, more stuff for them. And because of the 80-20 rule, these men wanted relationships with these women and were willing to do anything to get it. And they passed laws that were biased towards women. So these other 5,000 men, threw the 1,000 men to the curb to try and get laid, really.
Right.
And so when it comes down to it, men are thinking sexually. That's the reptilian brain speaking. So the reptilian brain, which is, the urge to breed, to propagate the species, will overpower, and that's the problem. It is an issue, and it's hard to recognize as a problem because when it's your reptilian brain, it's your own thoughts. It's not some external force motivating you or pushing you. It's your own thoughts. It's you thinking. So this is where the problem is that men are beginning to pull out of the system. They're beginning to realize that, they're not thinking right, and this leads to the degradation of society. And the reason is because the phrase has been mentioned is that the unmarried man has no vested interest in the survival of society, at least in general. And the reason is because when the man's single and he has really nothing to lose, will he care? And the answer is no. But a married man has a vested interest because now society really means the survival of him, his wife, and his children. The significant other and the child, because society is where you participate. But for the single man who has no interest in society, who does not really benefit from it, if anything loses because of it, isn't going to care, he might even expedite the end of society. So this is why it's worrying. This is why this movement's here, and you're going to see it. If you go and look for it, you're going to see it. With men pulling out of the system, this worries a lot of people, because if these guys are not participating and not, fulfilling their duties, it will lead to the degradation of society. It will destroy society.
Right.
So that's why this movement's important, because it's either it's going to get what it wants, because the reality is, and history validates this, and you can find it, men can live without women. Women can't live without men. Men live without having sex. And since they are typically the hunter-gatherers, they have the means and are more effective at survival, whereas women are not as effective. They're poor. So women will quite literally die without men, but men will not die without women.
Right.
And with MGTOW worrying society, it's even more worrisome, because now there's the advent of cloning, and yes, cloning, and there's been some rumors about potential long life thanks to the advances in modern medicine. So you can live a very long life without having to take too great a care of yourself because of medical sciences and whatnot. So men don't have to worry about taking care of somebody else. They can get the long life they want, and they can enjoy themselves and not have to potentially lose everything because some woman became vindictive because some other woman told her she should be. So MGTOW is a movement, like, I agree with the sentiment, and they have the evidence, at least Turd Flinging Monkey there, he cites a lot of his sources, it's in his descriptions. You can go watch his videos, they're there. And so he at least proves his point. I don't agree with the way he says it, because he, you know, he treats women as if they're animals, and I don't agree with that. But he does make his points, and he does support them.
Well, regardless as what, I mean, he does make a lot of solid points, and he has a lot of scientific theories, but the thing is that his scientific theories are hard to accept as scientific theories when a lot of what you say is biased and, you know, because a lot of his scientific theories are also clouded in that MGTOW bias, you know, the fact that he's MGTOW and he knows what he, you know, and so, while he has good points, it's also hard to take him seriously because, you know, he'll talk about the scientific theory he has, and then in the same breath, he'll talk about how women are scumbags, and it's like, dude. And the reality of the situation is that women need men, and contrary to what anyone chooses to believe, men need women. That's just fact.
Oh, I wouldn't say it's fact. In terms of survival, yes, men do need women.
Well, that's the end goal. Being a person means that, or rather, being human means that your goal in the end should be survival, both as a species and as a whole. And of course, we're going into some science here about the brain and mankind. But if your goal is not survival, then you are considered psychologically abnormal.
Right. You know, and there's such a thing as the antinatalist move. The natalist and the antinatalists. So the natalists are the ones who say, regardless of who you are like obligated to inject your genes back into the gene pool. And then there's the antinatalists who say, while some of their arguments seem very fatalistic, the reserve position is, no, I am not obligated. There's enough other fools in the world to, you know, put the genes back into the gene pool.
And that's true. You know, you have the right to say, no, I don't want to have kids. But like I said, that's considered the abnormal standpoint. Most of the time, you know, as a human, as a species, it is engraved in your DNA, for the most part, that you should be fucking bitches getting money. You know what I mean? It's a part of DNA, it's a part of species survival, every animal does it, including humans.
So, the problem isn't that men don't want to get married. I'm certain there's a lot of men who want to get married because, you know, it does sound great to have a lifelong partner, someone, you know, someone to care about you. It's just that women have been convinced by other women who maybe were probably women nobody wanted to marry in the first place, something like that. Maybe there was some vindication there, is that women have gotten too much and now they're demanding more. And it's not even their own thoughts, it's somebody else telling them to do it, telling them that you're insignificant if you're a housewife, you know, and that you're screwing the rest of the race by being a housewife and stuff like that. And it's now that they want more. You know, now the new feminist movement is pushing for men to just be outright jailed without a trial on rape accusations.
And that's not going to fly. We both know that's not going to.
Well, it's got weight some places. Some places you will get arrested. It's rare and you don't hear about it. But it does happen. And that's the scary part, is that it does happen. Because, you know, logic says, well, the cornerstone of justice is the assumption of innocence. You know, you can't assume that guy's guilty until it's proven. But if you're jailed, and that's what happens to some guys who are accused, they go straight to jail. They don't get a trial, they don't get detained, or anything. No, they're straight up jail. Now, I can't cite any instances because they're not out there, but they're happening. You could probably find, if you dug deep enough, some actual instances of it, but it's nothing that's right there in the public sphere that you can easily find. It'll probably take some digging. But there has been instances that I'm aware of that I could probably search and find, not to say, you know, so I don't sound like I'm sitting here spouting crap just because I can to support my argument.
Right.
And like I said, coming from the position, I think it's great people can get married because, you know, marriage is, you know, that's kind of the ideal, and that's what you work for. And it is mutual. It's supposed to be mutual. The woman can work, and the man can work, or the woman doesn't have to work, but, you know, you make each other's lives better. It's just the problem is that women have been told that they're insignificant. They've been convinced by their fellow women that they're not good enough being housewife or taking care of the children or doing the hard job of childcare and whatnot. They're being told this, and they're believing it. You know, if you hear something enough, you'll believe it.
Right, naturally, self-fulfilling prophecy.
And because our system is so biased toward women, because women are, you know, in terms of, you know, survival and breeding, they are worth more sexually than men are. Women are more important in terms of breeding than men. That's why one man can, you know, sleep with multiple women, but one woman can't have children with multiple men in a short period of time like men can.
Right.
Men can impregnate multiple women, but women can't impregnate multiple men. It's biologically impossible. It simply don't work that way. And so women have come to demand more, and men simply can't supply it, won't supply it, and it's heavily unfair. Because now it's not survival anymore, it's greed. It's people letting their ego speak, so to speak, and it's destroying society. You know, because now you have women who basically want to become lesbians, and, well, that's great, unless you get in vitro fertilization or something like that, which requires some part of a man. Even if the man's not there, you still require a man for that. And they say men or women don't need men. In reality, it's quite the opposite. And so the MGTOW movement is basically giving them what they want. They're walking away, saying, okay, you want that system, you can have it, but I'm not going to participate in it. I'm not going to have anything to do with it. And that, to me, is fine. That's the logical reaction.
See, but either way, you have to take part in it. You know, you have to live in a world where feminism is going to be prevalent in such a circumstance. So whether you say you want to take part in it or not, it don't matter, because either way, you have to live in that country. And I know part of his theory, and something that you've pointed out a few times, has been that you're waiting for feminism to cause a collapse in society. And I think that's an even worse prospect than... Because, like I pointed out before, a collapse in society usually means you're getting taken over by another country, or your country itself falls apart. And no one is going to benefit from that. Not feminism, not MGTOW.
And that's what's scary. That's why MGTOW is so scary, is that it's basically expediting the collapse of society. And there is a simple solution. Feminism simply needs to stop. They need to quit demanding more. They already have a lot. Maybe surrender some of what they have in order to bring the... Men aren't demanding all the shit back. They're just saying, be fair. We want this to be fair, like we were promised. And the promises were false. So now it's saying, well, if you're going to do this, then we're not going to care. If society falls, fuck it. That's the result. And it's simply to say that this is what you wanted, even if you don't believe it. You want more. Well, this is more. This is the result of your more.
Right. And
that's exactly it. So it's either, you know, you stop being it, or we're going to allow a collapse to happen. Fuck it.
Well, that's the thing.
Effects of that,
like I said,
nobody wins.
That concept is petty children saying, well, if I can't have my way, you're not going to get your way. And as I've stated before, it's going to benefit no one for society to actually collapse.
Well, that's the exact result. That's the intention. If it doesn't matter if you consider it to be petty or childlike, that is going to be the result. And that's going to be the desired result. Because we, like I said, single men have, particularly single men, but single people have no vested interest in the survival of society. They don't care who it benefits. You can always move. You can always survive by another means. Just society makes it easier. But now more is being demanded of you than you can provide for men. So, like I said, it doesn't matter if it's petty. It's just going to be the result. And they're going to say, well, this is what you wanted. Even if they say, no, that's not what we want. The logic is there. The results are going to happen. It's just, now are you going to keep doing it? Because these people would rather deal with the effects of a collapsing society than sit there and be told, shut up, bitch, make me a sandwich, and all that crap that feminism wants, that embodies modern feminism now.
Like I said, no matter the outcome, it's idiocy. It's an idiot's way, really.
Right, and
I guess that's my argument, is that MGTOW and feminism are both idiot movements.
Right, MGTOW sounds great.
They both sound great in theory.
I'm not going to try and attempt to defend MGTOW. I don't even identify as MGTOW, but I agree with the sentiment. It's more of a personal philosophy that's been brought up as a movement instead of something to do. You know, for men, yeah, don't get married, because frankly, it can screw you, depending on, what you want to do with your life. Some people just want the dream family. Fine, that's good for them. But if you want to, you know, work your way up to become like a CEO of a business, it would behoove you to, rather than get married, focus a lot of your time on developing your career. But typically the end result of that is that you gather the money, you gather the resources, and then you get married and have children. So you can satisfy, you know, all your needs. It's not being done out of spite. But MGTOW is being done in retaliation to feminism, and both sides are forcing the degradation of society. And then feminism says we're going to get what we want, but you got to pay for it, where the MGTOW says you'll get what you want, but we ain't paying for it. And then both sides will wind up paying for it. And that just, you know, it points out people don't care. Feminism wants everything for nothing, and MGTOW wants them to have everything for nothing, and the results are going to be disastrous. The men don't want nothing to do with it. And like I said, that's the logical argument. I'm not going to bash them. I'm not going to say it's childish, because it's logical. Frankly, children do it better than we do.
Well, yeah, children do it better than we do, but children do it better because they're children. Like I said, the class of society doesn't benefit anyone, and that's what both of these movements are pushing for. And the egalitarianism cycle happens to be a point of which I wholly agree with Turd Flinging Monkey's viewpoints on, because I disagree with him that it needs to be repeated, and I disagree with him that it should be repeated, because it should not be repeated. It's a bad outcome. It is not a good thing, which he seems to think.
Well, considering the alternative, yeah, that would be the good outcome, because like I made the argument earlier, men have greater capability of surviving than women, and it's just going to be like one big reset on the system. Because then women will be back into that position where they need men, they need that help, and men can simply say, no, I'm not going to help you, because we'll just get back, or it just restarts the cycle. They go back to the patriarchy, because after matriarchy is, I believe, chaos. You know, the complete degradation, society falls, everything falls apart, and then it starts back over. Men get back in charge, they start building, they start doing what men do, and then it goes back to egalitarian, matriarchy. It's a cycle. Everything is cyclical, really. You know, and there's going to be those who don't want it to happen, and there's going to be those who do want it to happen, and then there's going to be people like me who are kind of indifferent.
Right.
You know, it sucks, and, like, the fall of society is scary to me, because it does not guarantee my survival. I may not survive that cycle, and a lot of people won't survive that cycle. So that's why it's scary. But given the alternative of complete subjugation and slavery to the system, because women want it that way, and because other men are pussy-whipped, really, and bowed down to vagina, they'll more than happily sacrifice us for a little bit of that.
Right.
So, at least looking at it like that, would you blame me for not caring, or would you blame the other guy for sacrificing me because he wanted to get laid?
Here's the thing, is that both sides of the argument reality of the situation is, MGTOW isn't gonna go anywhere. And you know why MGTOW isn't gonna go anywhere? Because too many men like sex. MGTOW is doomed. MGTOW will never gain enough steam to make any kind of impact whatsoever. You can claim to be MGTOW, but like I said, by swearing off women, by saying, fuck that, I ain't gonna get into that, you know, I'm not having kids, I'm getting out of the system, blah 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 blah. Because that's the thing, is that, and I heard it from a MGTOW, because watching Turfling and Monkey's videos, it suggested to me a bunch of other stuff. It really, what it come down to, is that if, they say that if you fuck bitches, and you have children, you are not MGTOW, because you are in the, you know, you're taking part in society. And what that means is that too many men want sex. Because like I said, the idea of not wanting sex, the idea of being MGTOW, is considered abnormal. The idea of being feminist is not considered abnormal. Sure, feminists say, well, we fucking hate men and blah blah blah, and there are a few hardcore feminists that are like, that basically do the same shit MGTOW does, so where they're like, well, I don't want to be a part of that, I'm not gonna screw any men, men are evil, I'm just gonna be a lesbian. And, that, I mean, whatever floats their boat, you know, I guess they can do whatever the hell they want to do. But, in reality, what it's gonna come down to is the fact that really the MGTOW is about spiting women. Feminism is not about spiting men. A result of feminism is spiting men, but the movement itself is not about spiting men. And that's what the difference between MGTOW and feminism is that MGTOW is saying, fuck you women, just to spite you, because of your feminism movement, we're going to have a man movement of our own, and that's where MRA comes into it, the men's rights activists. But, it's not, it, you know, like I said, it comes down to more than that.
Right, well, you say not wanting to have sex is abnormal. Maybe it is. Because your reptilian brain will override your logical brain. You know, it's the reason why when you see a woman you find attractive walking down the street and she passes by, and it's your reptilian brain telling you to turn around and watch her walk away. That's not you. That's the other part of you that you aren't entirely aware of speaking and motivating you.
I disagree with that, because that's I do not believe in the concept of a reptilian brain. Because the reptilian brain really is just survival instinct. And regardless of, you can call it whatever the fuck you want, but when you watch a lady walk away, you know, or when you stare at a woman's chest, you're staring at that woman's chest because you think her tits are, you know, you like her tits. You're not staring at her tits because you don't like her tits. And that is all you. That is not your, some unforeseen portion of your brain. That's not you doing some weird crap. That is all you. And I don't, like I said, I don't care what anyone says about that. You know, you can't get out of that.
Well, reality is that it is a,
I didn't get whatever invite you, okay.
It's the amygdala. It's below the frontal lobe. That is the part of the brain that houses all your survival instincts. That's why even, you know, brain dead people continue to live. That their body functions on its own level. That's why you breathe and sleep and blink, and you don't need to think about it to do it. That is the part of the brain that controls it. That's the one that sends the electrical signals to your heart to keep it beating. And you don't got to think about beating your heart, because if you're thinking about beating your heart, you're quit thinking about breathing.
Right.
I mean, the reality is that that is a part of the brain, and it is there. That's why your sexual drive is active. Imagine if men didn't have any sex drive. There would be no sex. Sex would be boring. They'd look at a woman and be like, yeah, it's a woman, so what? Rather than looking at that woman and having, you know, lust-like thoughts.
Right. Well,
so The MGTOW movement is born of recognizing that, and yes, it is done despite feminism, but, you know, it, in the same principle, it was like the formation of the United States. You know, it's people being subject to systems they don't want to be a part of, that they don't like, that are unfair. So what do? They retaliate. They pull back. They quit participating. And you may disagree with the notion, because obviously that was a country against a country, but it's people doing the same thing. It's fighting each other. I mean, and eventually it'll get to the point where enough men... I think MGTOW has hope. It may be small, but there's hope there. There's always hope for it. And eventually it'll get to the point where women won't get married, and men will have had enough of an effect that they'll produce something called the bachelor tax, which is basically you're going to be paying more because you're single. It's going to punish you for not being married. So they're going to punish you for not cozying up to women. And they, you know, that's only going to push it further. Because even I don't agree with that. I don't want to be taxed because I choose not to have a relationship with a woman because I chose, you know, not to try and get laid and have kids now. I'm being punished for, you know, waiting for, because nobody, you can't discover other people's intentions. I mean, feminism at its core was, you know, well-intentioned, but it obviously became subject and they let some extremists drive it. And obviously MGTOW is subject to the same thing. So while, yeah, it is scary, we just got to be realistic. It's either women are going to pull back and the system's going to stop, or it's just going to fucking fall apart and nobody's going to care.
I ended up looking into that single-person tax, actually, and, as it turns out, that single-person tax, I don't know where you heard about it, but it's not true. The tax on single people was something that was being, what would you call that, proposed in 2013, and it was shot down almost instantly. Because of the fact that there have been numerous other countries in the history of the world who have also tried a single tax, and it has never worked out for them. Like, for example, ancient Rome and Greece both tried to implement a single tax, and it basically put the country in financial stress because no one would pay it, and, you know, they got fucked financially out of it. And in fact, more men became single just to prove a point against it.
Right. That's the exact result of it. And I never said it was implemented. I said it will result in that. Because how do you motivate men to get married, to force themselves into the system? By punishing them for not being in the system.
Right. But like I said, it was proposed in 2013 as being a possibility and almost instantly got shut down by everyone. So I know history is doomed to repeat itself, but I don't think that they're that stupid to try to implement it after having universal hatred for it.
Right, and they shot it down for a reason, but I...
Me, what about you?
I hardly believe it's going to come back up, because, you know, especially if Hillary gets elected, holy shit, you know, her and her self-proclaimed feminism... They're just going to push it because women are in charge right now, and they're getting more and more because other men are willing to sacrifice other men for a vagina, and that's sad. Of all things that's childlike, that would be it. You sacrifice your friends for some other bullshit that really is only instant gratification.
Yo, I gotta piss. I'll be right back, man. Like a 1 minute timeout.
Yeah.
It'll happen that way. Either women will pull back and they'll agree to make this mutual again, or shit will fall apart. That's simply reality, regardless of what he believes. Just trying to be realistic. Wish everything worked out ideally, but it don't.
I looked over here, and we have, like, 53 people listening to us bitch, and only one of them's actually talking. It's actually kind of funny to watch. But, my question here, MK Tosca, you said you love to be American, so I take it you live in America. I'm assuming. What are your thoughts on what's been said so far, if you don't mind sharing them?
Sure. Yeah, chat, ask questions, by all means.
Oh, yeah. Because, like I said, there's 53 people, and all of them are silent. It's like every time I look over and I see the view counter, we went from 2 to 23 to 42 to 53, and no one's talking at all. It's kind of creeping me the fuck out, except one guy.
Well, they probably don't give a shit about what we're talking about.
Well, they're listening, that's for damn sure.
Yeah, but, they're probably bored. They want to watch League of Legends.
Well, that's what I'm doing, you know. I'm playing League of Legends while I do that. Yeah, maybe they are here for the league. But who wouldn't be? You know, I'm that mad pro player. QQ. Anyway. As you were saying, Wookie, before I interrupted you and ran away.
Jeez, where was I? Well, I suppose I'd rather wrap up my argument. I believe I said all that needs to be said. I mean, the evidence is there. I don't sit here and advocate that I am infallible by any means or that I'm right, but the evidence is there. Go, you can find it. Rather than providing it, I'd rather tell people to look for it. Be much more successful than me.
Well, the internet's lazy people, Wilkie. You'll get better telling them if they're interested.
But when it comes down to it, MGTOW and feminism had honorable and honest and, you know, well-meaning intentions, but feminism, which came first, was hijacked by extremists. You know, seeking a lot more than what they, you know, could say deserved, earned, or even need. And MGTOW has done in spite of that. And, you know, I say the degradation of society, and you say that's scary, and it is. It should be.
No, I don't say it's scary. You know, I say it's idiocy. There's a massive difference between scary and idiocy.
Right. And, well, it should be scary. It should scare you, because that may be the case, because, you know, if everything does fall apart here and nobody cooperates anymore, you know, it leads to the destruction of the unity that built our country. If people, there's already massive mistrust because of immigration, and that could be another fun podcast. People, like I said, will stop caring, and society will fall, and shit will go bad, and that don't guarantee everybody survives, and that don't guarantee things go back to the way they were, but that's what people are choosing as the alternative. Women are demanding more, or at least feminists are. There are women out there who, you know, like things the way they are, or like them before, and that's great, you know, because that is when things were working the best, you know, because that, what people like to quote all the time and look at all the time is 1940s, 50s, 60s America, before the sexual revolution and all that. Back when there was the nuclear family, where, you know, the wife was stay at home and she was actually managed the money and helped take care of the family and the children. The husband was the breadwinner. He would go to work, he would come back, the wife would suck his dick, make him feel good, make him a sandwich, and everybody benefited, and that was great. But now you have the rise of this feminism where women are being told they're insignificant or, you know, worthless if they participate in a system like that. So they in turn turn that around and try to force men to pay for everything, and men don't see that as fair because, you know, we know we've been on top, we know we built shit, and we take care of women because we want to, not because we have to. And now the system has just been completely skewed, and the men are paying for it, so they're doing the only logical thing they really can do, no matter what it is, regardless of people's views on it. They're pulling out. And I don't blame them. I personally have no ill will towards them. They're doing what they feel is right. And it, you know, it, like I said, both movements were well-intentioned and well-meaning, but it simply didn't result in that. It got hijacked, and, you know, this is the result. And we got to put up with it. We got to take care of it now.
agree with you that it's well-meaning. You know, it's not like anyone here really wants to follow society, but anyone smart enough to realize that that's what's coming probably wouldn't be MGTOW, honestly, or feminist. And it's like, you know, TFM said before, is that really what it comes down to is that it, you know, it's women think they want their rights, and it really is a cycle, you know, it's patriarchy, egalitarianism, matriarchy, collapse of society. And if, I believe that if anyone realized that, I don't think anyone's stupid enough to willingly bring down society.
Well, when I see these movements, again, I look at the principle of it. It's, you know, the movements were done in retaliation to a system that the people perceived to be unfair, and that has to be, in order for that principle to work, for me to agree with it, it has to be merited on logic. And these men are performing the most logical choice, even if it doesn't benefit everybody else. I mean, when I look at things, my personal position that makes me, you know, that is like my personal mission in life, is that if I do anything, I want at least humanity as a whole to benefit. You know, and that's my position. I want people to benefit. I want people to be happy, regardless of who they are. So when I look at this movement, I see, again, it was done with well intentions, but they're going with the best course of action available to them. And the results are going to be disastrous if they can carry on the way they are. I don't think it will. I would hope it wouldn't. I'd hope people come to their senses. But they want, if one side's to back down, the other is to back down. I'm sorry, hang on.
Yep. Why? You fool! Not worth! Damn it! Oh no. Oh no. No 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 no. No 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 no. Blitz, why? Blitz, why?
Okay, sorry.
No problem.
So, like I said, I want what's best for society and for humanity, and, you know, that, I suppose that you could say that's the lens I look through, is why do these movements exist? Are they doing it to benefit somebody, to benefit themselves, to benefit everybody? And, you know, when I look at it, if in the ideal world both sides were to back down, because the way I see it, MGTOW, while being in retaliation to feminism, wants to kind of go back towards, you know, 1950s America. They want to bring back the nuclear family.
Bull! No. If they wanted to bring back the nuclear family, that would be what they would be advocating for. They're not advocating for a nuclear family. They're advocating for a fuck woman society.
I wouldn't say so. No. Like I said, this movement, again, you're... I suppose we could say it. TFM there, he is one of the extremists. He's a logic-based extremist, but he allows his emotions to, you know, more or less...
All right. So, we need to separate this, then. There's a difference between MGTOW and men's right activist. MRA and MGTOW are not the same thing. What I'm talking about is MGTOW. What you're trying to talk about is an MRA.
Right. That's true, but the people do confuse the two, and like I said, the movement's been hijacked by extremists. There are the extremists. That's who we look at. We don't look at the normal people who are advocating for normal terms.
Why are you so stupid, Blitz? No! Ah, damn it!
So you call me stupid?
Yeah, no, this Blitzcrank, man. He keeps going balls to the wall.
Right. With MGTOW, like I said, MGTOW at its core is, you know, to pull away from women. It's not to say they want the downfall of society. That's just a result. Correlation is not causation and all that good shit. So,
well, in a system like this, it would be. This is not correlation. Correlation is like, it just so happens that on hot days when more ice cream cones are sold, crime increases. Correlation, this is not correlation, this is direct causation.
Well, it's done in tandem with immigration and the election and all that shit, and that's a whole other discussion entirely. But MGTOW at its core is, like it is, it's men going their own way, which is men are pulling out of the system. Not just despite women, at least not all of them do it. That's not their intention. Because it does, and there's a new phrase for it that helps separate it, and it's called the neo-masculinity movement. And that's basically what MGTOW is, but because it's been hijacked by these extremists who are basically women haters, or men who want women to basically be animals and slaves, the neo-masculinity movement would better describe what MGTOW was before it got hijacked, really. And that is that men are focusing on their careers, they're focusing on their health, they're focusing on their looks. They're basically becoming everything women want, but they're not immediately engaging in, okay, you look good, let's fucking see what happens. Because relationships are based on compromise and understanding, and that doesn't happen anymore. I mean, look at the tweens in school. The girls all date, what, the jocks? The dumb football players, really. Not all of them are dumb, but that's the stereotype. That's the people they go after because they look good. Typically, they come from well-to-do families. It's kind of like a broad sense of the 80-20 rule being, you know, in action that you can witness. And who doesn't get dates? Typically, the guys who are like nerdy or do well or average. You know, they don't stand out, they don't cause trouble, and they don't get in trouble. Those are the guys who are kind of, you know, ignored or thrown to the wayside. And then, you know, women, as they grow up and they're chasing these guys who are, you know, they're hot and they cause trouble. And then they get in trouble and they lose everything or something like that. And they find out these aren't the men they want. Rather than looking around at the men they do want, they just bitch and say, where have all the good men gone? So, the MGTOW, before it was taken over, so I guess we could just say MGTOW is something that is perceived to be bad. Which was born in spite of feminism. It wasn't done despite women, it was done despite feminism. Feminism is not women. And feminism, as they call it...
Well, that's the thing, though, is that it is despite women. Because being MGTOW is not just saying, well, I'm not going to fuck anyone who relates as a feminist. No, it's like, I'm not getting with any woman, period. To be MGTOW means that you have sworn off women, not sworn off feminists. So, I mean, you can... We're going back to the whole unintentional consequence here, unintentional or not. You know, whatever you prefer to call it. Some may see it as intentional, some may not see it as intentional. But once again, we're going back to the whole, I've sworn off women, and that means feminist or otherwise.
Right, and it's not being done just despite those women. The intention isn't to make women feel sorry for themselves or to make
But it is, it's an unintentional consequence.
Because the system is in favor of women. It's being done to pull out of the system to not subject themselves to the laws that fuck them over. It's a handful of women guiding the larger populace who have become indifferent. Most women feel they deserve their alimony, deserve their child support. And I wouldn't say they're wrong, but I wouldn't say they deserve it. If that woman is completely capable of supporting herself, then she should do so. She should not be given a free handout. But again, the circumstances aren't being laid out as they are. It's just saying all women are incapable, that's why they need the help, except these women are saying they're capable and don't need the help. It's backwards logic. It's fucked up.
Right.
If I'm willing to bet, I would bet money on it, that if these laws were to change and the demands were to be met and they were to, you know, they're not saying take alimony away, they're saying apply the circumstances fairly. So if that woman's a fucking crack whore with three kids with three different guys, should she receive help for it? Should her kids be taken away from her? You would think so. But instead, the system will more than likely hand her alimony from whoever she was married to, get her child support either out of that guy or from Social Security, and it's going to fuck guys in the end, because guys are the biggest tax base. They earn the most money in society. They produce the most. It's the takers and the makers. It's the takers taken from the makers. The men are the makers, the women are the takers. And before, the relationship was mutual. But now it's being done to just cover all women. There's no woman here in the country that can have a kid and be a single mom and not get help. And that's part of why there's a problem, is that men are just being screwed to support these women who are making bad choices and not deciding to stick with their men.
Right.
That's why the marriage laws are against them. Why get married?
See, but that's marriage laws. That's not... That I completely agree with the marriage side of MGTOW, and that's where I was going, you know, with before when I was saying that I do agree with some of the things he says, because when it comes to marriage... Men get the ass end of the deal. You know, you don't win if you're a man and you're getting married. You know, if anything goes wrong in that marriage, you're the one who gets fucked. And I agree, and I acknowledge that.
And that's one of their primary arguments. Frankly, that was probably the primary argument. And then it begins to break down into all the other ways men get screwed. But marriage is the primary one, because that's what's expected. That you're expected to be married. The you know, years ago is like when you turned 18 or 19 or you're in your 20s, you were married out of the house, you were on your way in a career, and you had a wife and possibly a kid. That was the way things were. But now, because, again, feminism has seeped its way in and applied its, you know, its strengths, the laws are now, well, if you don't get married, you get in trouble. And you're frowned upon, and things stop working your way.
Right.
And now feminism is demanding more, so it's being done in retaliation against that. Like I said, honest intentions. I don't see the movement as that bad, but...
Well, I don't see either movement as that bad. It's just, although I will say you are definitely right on the whole hijacked by extremist point. Because it does seem like, you know, kind of like the vocal majority, or the vocal minority rules, you know?
Yeah, it sucks. Like I said, you know, there's not much that can be done. We're talking about it, but what's to be done about it? And frankly, it's out of our hands. It's what society wants, you know, and society's being guided by the invisible hand of feminism and MGTOWism and all that shit. And, you know, I advocate for fairness. That's what I want. You know, I basically want what both sides want, but both sides want more than what they need, deserve, or what, even if they acknowledge what they really want.
Right. So
it's obviously going to get blown out of proportion. That happens to most movements. They get taken over and it disappears. You know, like for instance, the Occupy Wall Street. That was actually, as I've seen, was that was originally an anarcho-capitalist movement against, you know, regulation. They wanted to pull down the regulations on the market, and a bunch of the socialist and, you know, basically the people who hate the rich showed up and hijacked that movement, and it became, oh, these are people who are sick of getting fucked by rich people. When it didn't start that way, it was people sick of other people fucking with the rich, saying let the rich, you know, spend their money how they please, and, you know, maybe things will get better. Obviously, all these movements are born of a high hope that things work out the way they want them to. And as we should know from history and experience, no matter what happens, shit never works out the way you want it to.
Right.
So, like with everything, it's well-meaning. I mean, I'm just saying, really, I'm disagreeing with your definition that, you know, MGTOW leftist people and hate women. Yeah, again, that's the extremists, but the MGTOW, or better described as the neo-masculinity movement, is basically guys focusing on themselves, and if they are going to have a relationship, it's going to be a relationship based on reason, logic, and fairness versus, you know, whatever your dick's telling you.
Right.
You know, what you might call the baby boomers. What was the original baby boomers? The people who, you know, in retrospect could be seen as pushing this movement, because they're the ones who kind of went out and just had lots of kids and, you know, completely counterculture, and now we've established the counterculture again. It's just a cycle. It's repeating itself on a smaller scale. So, you know, we can talk about it, but the reality is that you know, me and everybody in our generation is going to be footing the bill for this shit. And I'm not going to foot the bill. I refuse. I'm not going to pay for somebody else's fucking mistakes. That's happened for too long. I'd rather hit the restart button and try again. You know, it sucks, and not a lot of people are going to benefit, but I'd rather have a chance.
That's the thing, Wookie, is that there really is no restart button. I mean, you keep talking about the restart button, but when it comes down to what you're asking from, because the restart button is going to start a society that isn't going to work. That's the thing, is that the society we start will not be the society we want. And no one will benefit if society collapses. No one. And because of that, it's always going to end in a situation where it's either going to be war, or it's going to be a financial collapse. And, you know, if it's via financial collapse, no one wins. Depressions kill millions. A lot of population dies when economic collapse comes into play. And if it's by war, then it's not going to be our choice anymore. There will be no more movements when China takes over America. You know what I mean?
Right. Well, and this is where the argument's going to stop being about MGTOW and start being about something greater than that. And that's going to be a whole other thing. I'm not as well educated. I'm learning slowly, but I don't entirely understand it. But here, I'll send this to you, and you can look it up. I'll send you a couple links. And just kind of pay attention to these. They may seem one-sided, but pay attention. Make it through them.
Hold on. How can I do this?
Couple.
Because I want to be able to display them for the stream. And, like, it can't just be me. You know what I mean? Because we're arguing for the stream here, and you sending me videos is going to benefit the stream. So I got to figure out a way to make them visible to everyone.
I think you'd have to leave League there first.
No, I would not end up having to leave. Well, that wouldn't change anything, honestly, but I gotta figure out a method.
Some of them may just want to watch on your own and learn. The second one there, they speak about how when it comes to depressions, when the government takes a hands-off approach and, you know, leaves it be, it actually corrects itself fairly quickly.
I've never seen it correct itself very quickly. I mean, we're going into, like, modern-day Greece territory, and they have not corrected themselves in a long time. You can also argue Soviet Russia, and they still have not correct themselves. I mean, a lot of people say...
No, I think you mistook what I said there. When I say the government takes a hands-off approach, meaning letting the economy do what it does, rather than, you know, throwing in regulations and throwing money at the problem, rather than that, it's let the economy fix itself, because that's what the economy is going to do. It's going to fix itself. If it doesn't work, it will fix itself. You know, thinking of it as an entity. You know, Greece, the reason Greece is in the way it is in is because the government went in and they you know, they threw all these social programs in, it threw the government into debt. They're borrowing heavily. And what the fuck did they call them? They called them the something laws. You know, it's like the decadence laws or something like that, which is basically to cut back their spending.
Right, okay.
So
that's the thing, though, is that
it needs to be the other way. Let the government step away rather than stepping in.
In the modern world, the government can't step away financially, though. I see what you're saying, and you might be right. I don't recall how we got out of the Great Depression, so I wouldn't know. But
excuse me. It was a result of, if I could be very general about it. For one, it was the war. So a lot of men went away to fight the war, which pushed a lot of women into the workforce. So
right, industry.
Employment by, so there's the development of industry. And when you could say some of the social programs went in and made a difference, but the reality was is that when it came down to the farmers in the industry, the people who own those businesses will do what they think is best for themselves, and they're the ones who will build the factories, will put forth the money in the development, and people will then go and get hired. They'll apply for the jobs, and people will begin to get an income, because regardless of depression or not, if you're not working, you're not eating.
Right.
You'll die if you don't. So even if it's a job you hate, people will go get a job because it means their survival. So rather than the government stepping in and, you know, it did in that case, it did some, but it's very gradual compared to, like, these immediate programs that are expected to get results within 2 to 3 years. And frankly, those systems are gone now. They were taken over by LBJ during the 60s after Kennedy's death. But the economy, as it's gone through history, is fairly self-repairing, because if it's not profitable, they won't do it. People will always basically have work, and some of them will even, well, majority of them, in fact, will go and get skills of some kind, and that leaves them employable. But now we have, you know, they'll call it the welfare state, but there's welfare, there's Social Security, there's so many things that really leave you without a reason to go and look for work or to gain any sort of skills.
But you're also sidestepping the fact that during an economic collapse, war happens. And during the Great Depression, the war you're talking about, World War One, right? We were lucky enough to be on the side of the war that had the most power. Because...
Well, I meant World War Two. I was talking like...
World War One, World War Two. Yeah, yeah.
Was right around World War II era, because that, like I said, that's when all the men went away. That was when there was the draft and the men, you know, went to war. It was a much bigger war. Well, yes and no. World War One, you could say, did develop some economics, because much of France and Germany was destroyed because of the trenches and the artillery and the gas attacks. So some industry was developed to attempt to recover those lands. But when it came to World War II, the majority of men left, and then women had to step into the factory work and, you know, take over the places of men. They had to. You know, that it's what the hell they call her, the Fighting Dixie, or whatever the fuck her name was, the poster woman. So, and in a way, the economy did correct itself. The men went to war, the women went to work, and businesses started gearing towards, because majority of car factories and shit were turned over to produce weapons, you know, guns, tanks, planes. So new factories had to be built to meet consumer demand for other products, and, you know, that employed people. So, and that kind of spurred the way. And then we experienced an economic downturn when the war ended, because now all those men came back from war, and the jobs they had are gone because the women took them over. And, like, the only benefit they had, really, was the GI Bill to encourage them to go to school, to go to college, to get something.
Naturally.
So, you know, war is a great way to get rid of your unemployment, because the majority of men will disappear off to war, go fight, you know. Your employment rate will drop, because all the unemployed people just suddenly got employed very quickly. But, holy shit, we got way off track. Anyways, so I guess probably the best way to put it, and I heard this somewhere, I forget, but you know, feminism and MGTOWism. Feminism is a result of decadence. You know, it's a result of people becoming fat and lazy, and you know, kind of wanting more for less. And you know, MGTOW is kind of being done in, almost solely in spite of feminism. You could say in spite of women. I don't entirely agree with that point, but
no, it affects all women. I mean, you can argue that point, but from a realism standpoint, it does affect all women. People say, yes, it fights feminism, it's meant to bash feminism, but it affects all women. When a man says, fuck women, I'm done with that, it's not just the feminists that have to deal with that.
Right, yeah. No, you're not wrong, but, you know, they're matching it scale for scale, so if all the laws are going to benefit the women, and the women who don't want that aren't going to really step up and fight, you know, they're going to be, you know, roped into the fight regardless. So, you know, the retaliation is to reject all women, even if you're not meaning to hurt the ones who, you know, are on your side, you know, so to speak. You know, it's the same way. If all men are going to pay the bills, all women are going to, you know, be subject to that. It's, you know, it's almost... evenly balanced at right now, and it'll start tipping one way or the other soon, I would imagine.
Like I said, unfortunately for MGTOW, it's going to end up tipping in a point of feminism, because like I said, MGTOW is a very spiteful movement, and feminism is not born from spitefulness where MGTOW is. And because of that, not a lot of people are going to join MGTOW. A lot of people are going to be feminists. Any girl can be a feminist. Not all pussy-loving guy can be a MGTOW. Because that's another thing is you can argue, but I've seen, in doing my research, I've seen what happens when a man who wants sex tries to join the MGTOW community, and they get bashed. Because if you don't swear off women, you can't be MGTOW. They basically tell you to go fuck yourself, and you get bashed by the people you're trying to join. They will not let you be MGTOW if you like pussy. Really.
Again, I'm gonna have to disagree. Like, MGTOW, if you were to be the ideal MGTOW, yeah, you'd have to swear off women.
Well, they make you swear off women. That's the thing, is that if they will not let you call yourself MGTOW if you... And this is not only what Turd Flinging Monkey has said, but also what a few other MGTOWs that I was listening to, because he got me into... He made me curious about what MGTOW was, and it was other people who I started to get my concept of MGTOW from. And like I said,
right,
they pretty much made it damn crystal clear that they... that MGTOWs will not let you call yourself MGTOW if you be fucking bitches. Because it's against what the MGTOWs want.
We're looking at the loudest people, you know, obviously, the extreme.
And it's the loudest people who have the voice, though.
Right. So, you're not looking at the heart of MGTOW, what it is. You're looking at the people who are screaming the loudest and saying, hey, they're the ones leading this fucking... Maybe they are, but that does not represent the core of the issue, you know, the core of what that organization or that movement is. They may be up there screaming and saying this is what it is, but then that'd be to say you're listening to the most extreme feminists who basically advocate for the castration and subjugation of men, and saying that's what feminism is.
That's the thing, though, is that you can't call yourself MGTOW. It's not about who's loudest, not about who's talking more, it's a part of being a MGTOW. Part of being a MGTOW is swearing off women, and as a result, you cannot, and they will not let you call yourself MGTOW. They'll tell you, they will actively deny you, and tell you instead that if you want to support men, go be an MRA. They'll divert you to being an MRA instead of being a MGTOW, because they won't let you be a MGTOW. It's not something that's just the loudest people, it's something that's all MGTOWs, because it is a direct violation, It's like going and joining the NRA and hating guns. It's like, you know, you can't be a part of the NRA and at the same time say, well, fuck guns, I don't want to own a gun. It's like, it contradicts everything they do and stand for.
Well, and we've already had this argument, really. Like I said, MGTOW at its core is done in spite of feminism, blah, blah, blah. And then there's the neo-masculinity movement, which is really what MGTOW started as. It was to reject marriage and to reject relationships with women in favor of self-development. But the MGTOW we're seeing now from TFM and all the others, I imagine you saw, what, Sandman and Sexy MGTOW and Angry MGTOW and all those guys out there.
I don't remember the names.
Those are the guys who want... Those are the guys who basically want complete subjugation and the return to the way things were. And I disagree with that. I disagree with them. I only like TFM because he supports much of his evidence, but I don't like the way he, you know, says it and all that. And I agree with the notion, like I said, marriage is unfair. And that's kind of what MGTOW at its core was largely against. Feminism and the unfair marriage laws. Because everybody's demanding you get married, or you're not a real man, or you're not, you know, what's the phrase now? You need to be a real man. You need to man up and put up with the bullshit. No, fuck that. Real men change shit. If it don't work, they fix it.
Right.
Except, you know, the system's broken, and the feminists are saying, no, the system's not broken. Don't fix it. And the men are saying, no, it is broken, and we're going to fix it. And they're fixing it the only way they know how, by pulling out of the fucking system. Now, MGTOW, yeah, maybe it's an extreme, but I disagree with the extreme. I like the core issue, so I suppose I'd have to start calling it the neo-masculinity. Because, you know, to you, you see MGTOW as, you know, the oppressor, or, like, the people who...
I don't see MGTOW as the oppressor.
Fucked up.
I see MGTOW as... I agree with you, kind of, on the aspect that MGTOW... That MGTOW is kind of... What would you call that? In MGTOW is like, well, fine, fuck you, women. You know, if you want this, we want this. I don't see MGTOW as being oppressors. I see MGTOW as being childish. But I see feminism as being childish, too. Because, like I said, they go hand in hand. MGTOW would not exist if not for feminism. I see both sides of the argument as being bullshit children.
Right. So, I guess I'll have to use the new one, the neo-masculinity, which is the one I like. Which, while it's resistant to relationships with women, it's more about self-development. Make yourself better, and then build relationships on understanding, and not the way, you know, they are now, which is like, you know, hey, you look good, you look sexy, let's see if this works out. You know, because relationships need work, and, you know, I guess that's kind of what people are interesting, is that relationships don't need work, it just happens and it works, or it doesn't. No, you make it work. That's the whole point. You get together, you support each other, and you make it work. Instead, there's this fucking unrealistic concept that I don't even know where it came from, that, you know, if it happens, it's going to work, and if it doesn't work, just, you know, fuck it, it don't. And people will... They expect it to work out, and, you know, now the laws are in favor of the women. And so, in terms of MGTOW, yeah, I'd say I agree, because, you know, not a lot of women are pushing for the reforms that would make things equal.
Right.
You know, if you're not going to work for it, why should you have it? So, and unless I go on to become, like, some prominent fucking politician, I'm not interested in... You know, no, I don't care. I'm not going to participate in that system. I disagree, and I'm not going to man up and deal with it just because somebody told me to. They can go fuck themselves. So, I mean, I know you're married, and so your line of thinking is going to be different, and that's understandable, and I'm not going to bash you for being married. I think it's a graveyard. You know, that's awesome. At least somebody believes in the system still. But I don't. And there's not much that'll convince me unless I see the reforms that I want, which is largely just, you know, change the divorce law. Then I won't have an issue with marriage. Then things will... I think if that's what happens, things will mellow out. Feminism will, if they allow it, will die, and MGTOW will disappear with it. And that'll be great. Everything will go back to whatever we perceive to be normal, I guess. But with the way things are... And this is about the only reason I agree with MGTOW is, yeah, it's biased against men, so fuck that, I don't want to participate in it. That's the best way I can do it. In the same way, if you disagree with, say, a product, somebody makes a product, and you don't like it, you don't buy it.
Right, buy of course.
I don't endorse that product. So I don't endorse the system. I'd rather watch it fall apart, frankly. I'm not going to subject myself, and I'm not going to be forcing subject myself to that system. It's shitty, and it does go more to the extreme. There is no really good middle ground unless we build it, but most people don't want it, and it's just not going to work. But I'd rather take the system of, I don't want to subject myself to that, and whatever happens, happens. We'll just have to work through it. Like I said, I didn't come here to argue the defense of MGTOW.
Right.
Its core elements, the reason why it was made in the first place. I don't agree with the people who then changed it around, and some of them sound like they outright want fucking sex slaves with women.
Right.
No, hell no.
So I guess
it ties into the greater arguments.
Right. So then I guess given the situation, then it's what you're saying that you're arguing for is less about MGTOW and MRA and more about marriage reform.
Almost. There are other issues that I can't recall off the top of my head, but. Again, I come from the sentiment of fairness. I don't want unfair. I don't want one side to have more power than the other, because that fucks shit up. That's when stuff does get bad, and that's what's happening. Feminism already has the majority support. They have the support of the many. They have the support of politicians, and whether they earn that support legitimately or not, because it is perceived that they'll ply their vagina. They know that they have control. They are the gatekeepers of sex, and they can use that against men. And MGTOW, like I said, was born of, understand that they, it is your own thoughts, and you need to resist them, really.
Right.
But, and then I, hijacked and all that. I don't want to repeat myself constantly. But if there was a label, I guess it would have to be the neo-masculinity movement, which is what MGTOW was at its core before it got changed.
Now,
self-development, and if you're going to have a relationship, let it be based on mutual support, respect, and admiration, rather than these weird relationships that children have now.
Now, you'll have to explain to me the difference between MGTOW and neo-masculinity movement, because I'm unable to look it up myself right now. So, what would you say the difference between the two would be?
Well, MGTOW is, I would say, all about being manly. Doing manly things. And TFM kind of walks the line between the two, because he wants the two to be the one and the same, but he leans more toward the manly, do manly things, and it's all about bringing back what was masculine. And the neo-masculinity movement more or less embodies just that, except it's more about self-development. Push your career forward, make yourself as successful, do what you want, and be successful at it. Focus on your health, so they want people to, become sexy, become that ideal man. And then, so it's health, wealth, and making yourself a good person.
Right.
And that's what MGTOW was before it got changed into the system of, fuck women, if they're not gonna, come back into the fold, let them fucking die. Neo-masculinity is indifferent to that and just says develop yourself, become the dream man that women want, but do it because you want to do it, not because somebody told you to do it. There is a very blurry line between the two, but it's there. See if I can't find a better definition rather than my own.
Right, okay.
See, these movements were around for a while, just they're becoming popular now. So, let's... Didn't get much of a definition anymore. across one big long fucking article. Okay, so neo-masculinity, and this is an article written last year around May by Roosh V.
Right, okay.
The way he defines it, this is more or less his definition, not mine. So neo-masculinity combines traditional beliefs, masculinity, and animal biology in the ideological system. It aims to aid men in living in westernized nations that lack qualities such as classical virtue, masculinity in males, femininity in females, and objectivity, which especially concerns beauty ideals and human behavior. It serves as an antidote for males who are being programmed to accept Western degeneracy, mindless consumerism, and immoral state authority. The purpose of this article, you know, well, that's the article. And then it goes on to, you know, it's like, you know, what is the game? What were the traditional sex roles? What the patriarchy did? Understanding the nature of women. And then there's the self-improvement, which is the one which for a while is what was the center of it, which is, you know, fitness, responsibility, a hardworking ethic, and optimization of the lifestyle.
So it sounds more about optimizing men's lifestyle than it is really about saying fuck women or fuck men or fuck this or fuck that.
Right. You know, it's
kind of something like Elliot Hulse would get into, really.
Right. You know, you could probably say he might have even, you know, read this shit and, you know, born his idea, you know, some of his ideas from it. And, you know, even he said, though, if you've seen one of his older videos, I've seen it a while ago, is that when he got married, he did it based on, you know, that they were going to support each other. Not that, you know, they thought each other was sexy because he was lifting weights and she was thin, and then she comes to hate him and leave him and take his shit, you know.
Right.
Like, their relationship is born on, or is sustained on understanding, you know, and they satisfy each other, and they basically represent a good man. He does what he wants to do, she does what she wants to do, and it just so happens his is going out and doing shit and running his business. He does run a gym, he does make money.
Right.
And she, in turn, she exercises too. There's a couple of videos there of him exercising with his, or her exercising with her husband, that she's into it. But she,
I think at one point he said that she's more into, like, cardio and not so much into...
He gets her doing some of the stuff, but, like, she's not going all out to be buff. But, yeah, she, you know, she exercises, and she goes to her husband because he's the obvious choice. He understands.
Right.
Done. You know, he taught. But she would represent, I believe he said, she's the traditional housewife, and it makes her happy. She's happy doing that. She had, like, what, 4 kids? And he takes care of them, and she takes care of them. But, you know, that's her primary role, and she likes it. If she's complaining about it, we're not seeing it. And that's kind of what all these movements, regardless of what they mean, really want, is to return back to 1950s America, where the mother, without limiting her, you know, if the woman wants to go out and have a job, she can do that. But the desire is to go back to that, where the woman is the housewife and the man's the breadwinner. That was the quote-unquote nuclear family.
Right.
And you know, at least back then, it wasn't the people who were the family, the parents, they weren't complaining. At least I don't think they were. It was the kids who kind of went off and did different things, but that's what kids do. You know, teenagers do. They go out and try different things. But the nuclear family itself, nobody had an issue with that. It worked. And that was kind of the center of why America succeeded the way it did. Especially in the 19th century.
Right.
19th, 20th century. You know, well, yeah, no, 19th century. Get me backwards. And that's kind of what these movements want, you know, because they have sexual marketplace value, which is, you know, what are you worth to a woman, which is why it goes to self-improvement, you know, make yourself look, you know, develop a career and be successful at it, be responsible, optimize your lifestyle so you can have money and do things, and that draws in the women, and then you take the woman, you pick a woman, and you make it work. Yeah, you know, even so, now you're throwing the box, you know, nuclear family. But, you know, it's understanding the nature of woman. You know, that was one of the things MGTOW did. That's what TFM did. And it's... Let's see. I'll use his rather than my own. Right, so, yeah, see, this is... You ever... Like, the concept of cheating. And women... I've heard they are more likely to do it, but it's not by much. Like, there's a small... They're slightly more likely. I don't know, I don't remember.
I've heard they were significantly more likely, actually. But that's something I've heard. I mean, you can find statistics for almost anything you want to believe.
Yeah, you know, and that's another thing. I'll just say it now before I forget. There's the tyranny of statistics. You can, yeah, like you said, you can quite literally find any statistic to support any hypothesis, no matter how far-fetched or fucked up it is. It is possible. You can find numbers to support anything. And that's what makes, like, debates hard, because that's what a lot of people latch on to, is the statistics. Well, statistically speaking, women are more likely to cheat, and statistically speaking, men are, like, and this is an actual number, this is actually more supported than the others. Men are 5 to 6 times more likely to fucking commit suicide than women.
Right.
Or, actually, no, I'm sorry, that's wrong. No. The reality is that men are 5 times more likely to be successful at committing suicide, so succeeding in taking their own life, but women are more likely to try it. So, men are better at it.
Men would be better at death.
She'll try, but we'll just get it right the first time, so... Anyways... So...
Well, you know what they say, Wilkie, you want to get something done right, you get a man to do it.
Yeah, right. But, you know, this has been said, that it's really that women are very easy to understand, you know, instead of that propagandized women, you can't understand a woman. That's because you said you can't. I understand you almost quite perfectly. and this is done, again, for the sake of survival, women will search for the best mate, you know, the most successful mate.
And right.
In a very hostile world, that is the, you know, the alpha male. You know, the big dude who gathers the most shit. Although he's a taker rather than a maker. He, you know, the alpha males succeed by taking from those who succeeded on their own as well. And that's where the 80-20 rule comes in. 80% of the women are trying to sleep with 20% of the men, because roughly 20% of the men are alpha males, and the rest are, well, not alpha. They call them betas, but there's different fucking levels for different things. You know, alpha males are basically considered to be the least intelligent, but the most physically apt, and thus the most likely to survive conflict.
Right.
And while that's great in a hostile environment, in the environment we're in now, where the world isn't trying to kill you, where you can walk out of your house and not be eaten by a fucking dinosaur or some shit like that, it's not beneficial. That, in fact, destroys society. Because now 80% of the women are ignoring 80% of the men, and that... It leads to a much smaller populace. It destroys civilization. Hence why there's the hypergamy system, which gives everybody a fairly equal chance at, you know, finding a mate. But again, it's rooted in your survival instinct. So hence why the women go after these supposed alpha males. You know, like the jocks in school, the sports guys who don't do nothing else but play sports. God knows we had a lot of those when you and I were in school.
Oh yeah.
And who were the girls fucking after? Those guys. You know, then those guys, I think, walk around all the time with girlfriends. But now, that they're out and they're finding that those guys aren't the ideal, because they tend to go out and get in trouble now. You know, the system, society doesn't support them in what they do now. You know, it's not looking for the gather the most. Now it supports the smart people, right? You know, the intelligent people that go out and get really good jobs and careers and make a lot of money. Those are the guys with the women. And that's because they, you know, they know subconsciously, it's in their instincts. They will search. You know, at least here it says, this is where it should be, but the evidence is there. I've seen some studies and such. TFM has them too. It says women are reactionary on their mate picking. So if survival is hard and her basic food and shelter needs are difficult to attain, she'll latch onto a provider at an early age to aid in her survival. But if survival is easy and her food and shelter are met, she'll pursue more base hedonistic instincts while later shopping around for the most high status male. So if your needs are met when you're young, you have food and you have shelter. So then they go and search for the guy who's highest in status.
Right.
So, you know, thus that's like the rich people. But there is a fairly well backed up statistic that the wealthy tend to have fairly successful marriages. gee, I wonder why, because they have...
Oh, yeah, no, that's well known, though, you know, you see some Hugh Hefner-looking motherfucker, you know, at the age of 80, married to some 23-year-old fucking bombshell model, you know. There's a reason. And realistically speaking, they both get something from that relationship, you know. Right. He gets a 23-year-old wife, you know, every man's dream bitch, and she gets, well, money.
Yeah, you know, and that's because in women, you know, how do they make themselves attractive to that man? By, you know, vanity, really. You know, they focus on their looks. They make themselves look really good. They take pride in it. And that's how you attract that male. You know, so that's why if they're passing in an environment, they'll catch each other. You know, and it works. You know, it just works that way. You know, I mean, there's really no other way to put it. Women search out for the most successful male. It's innate. It's interesting, but it's innate. They know. And that's what the neo-masculinity movement's about, is to make yourself successful. Get your career, you know, make yourself look good, make yourself attractive, and then draw in that female you want. But one of the core things that, at least to me, if it's not here, I would add it, is that to have that relationship built on understanding. Well, yes, you're drawn in by your innate survival instincts. You need to understand that, hey, just because we're attracted doesn't mean shit's going to work out.
Right.
You need to understand that, you know, the man's going to work and maybe the woman's going to work. And while it may be preferential that the woman stay home if you ever have children, she can still work and, you know, you'll have to balance the needs and wants. You know, so making it like a two-step process. The first step, make yourself good, make yourself successful so you can attract that good-looking woman, that woman who wants to be there. And then the second step is build that relationship on understanding. Marry each other for the right reasons rather than just because she looks good and you look good. That's likely how shit's going to fail. Because then you're going to realize the guy looks good, but maybe I hate this little thing about him. And the guy will go, I hate that little thing about her. And then get divorced, and then it goes right back to the marriage law where the guy gets fucked over. Again, well-intentioned, because women were seen as incapable of protecting themselves. Well, society has made it quite possible for them to not only protect themselves, but to succeed on their own merit. Women can become CEOs now. You know, it's not like there's laws against it. So there's, frankly, those laws have no reason to exist. But, anyways, I don't want to go back to that argument.
Right.
But it's there, you know, the neo-masculine movement, make yourself better, draw in the female, and then I would add, it doesn't explicitly state it, but add, build that relationship on understanding. And you'll succeed, and unless you have some particular stick up your ass, you'll be happy.
Naturally.
So, but now, we live in a society that rewards people for not doing shit. Feminism is encouraging women to take. MGTOW is that's fucked up all now. I suppose it ain't even worth going back to. I'd rather speak about neo-masculinity, which was, as I've said before, what MGTOW started as, but then, you know, the hijacking and all that, and it's no longer that.
All right, Wilkie. Well, what we're going to do here is...
What the?
Is take a 5-minute break. Because I got to piss, and I don't know about you, but I'm kind of hungry, so I'm going to grab something like a snack or some shit, you know? So, I don't know what you're going to do, but we'll reconvene in 5 minutes.
All right.
Once I was seven and oh, till the dragon ganked me. He's phasing through terrain while he was roaming. Once I was seven and oh. Creates a newborn star and then he makes it bigger. When he's coming after me, he's always moving quicker. By 11 minutes, it's his fifth time down the river. Getting slapped by his balls, it's got my whole team triggered. Now he's 11 and oh, my midlane told me, go sit in base if you just gonna be feeding. How's he 11 and oh? Forgot he had a team B, cause he's all that I see. So let's catch the others out and we can pick up a lead. But then without a warning, kills us while we're warding. A dragon with short arms and legs, he's just a cosmic corgi. I fought Aurelion's soul, he countered with Thor. I had him but he pushed me back and slowed me. Killed by Aurelion's soul. I'm just trying to get by pushing a small wave of creep. From the edge of fog of war, I see him headed for me. With all of that movement speed, I had to burn flash to retreat. But how can I avoid a stun the size of a galaxy? Soon it'll be 60 and oh, they should have already won. But he won't take our towers down, cause he's still having fun. I cannot wait to report this guy when the game is done. But there's no way that this can end without him dying once. Must kill Aurelion. My goal, or will I have to let him finish legendary? Must kill Aurelion's soul. Must kill Aurelion's soul. Will I carry out my goal, or will I have to let him finish legendary? Must kill Aurelion's soul.
The water was cold, and my boy Timo says,
your size doesn't matter.
At least I'm viable enough to help climb the rank ladder. My parlay hits so hard that it'll make your screen shatter. Your trap's designed so bad it makes the client bug splatter. I make people rage after they're laning with me. ADAP tanky, either way it's GG. How can you manage all the damage of my gun and scimitar? And try to run however far, you won't escape from my R.
What you say is hard to hear you from your island up top. I hear your teammates only see you when you go back and shop. And when my team decides to group up, they can always count on me. While yours, on the other hand,
where the fuck was GDP?
I remember when they took you out of the game. It was the best week of my life and everyone else thought the same.
They really burned, but that's gay. I can just eat an orange. Oh no, I messed it up. I don't know what rhymes with orange.
Okay.
Back again.
Yep.
Zachary, are we still streaming?
Always. I just threw up a quick paint thing this 5-minute break, and I drew it, like, on stream. Kind of delicious.
Well, it looks like you got 69 viewers.
Quite a few, yeah.
Talking about society and its fall. I don't know if society will fall, more or less. Just, well, I don't know. Dystopian future. Come on, fucking the stuff of legends.
There. Dystopian futures and why you suck as a person. Error updating broadcast. What the fuck? Raggle Fraggle.
Yeah, nobody's asking questions. I figured I'd type something in there. Hopefully get somebody to say something. 69 viewers and nobody's got an opinion? Come on.
Oh, I know, right? It's abysmal. I can't update the broadcast. It makes me a little sad.
Oh, dear.
Man, I can't get an update. Oh, yeah, okay. Twitch didn't recognize I was logged in. That's why I won't update. There we go. Alright, let me log back in. Why you suck as a person. Well, lovely. Alright.
Okay, how do we push this along?
So, anything else we need to discuss on the topic of MGTOW and feminism?
I'm pretty sure we beat that dead horse with a stick. Maybe with a baseball bat. Smashed it with a tank.
I don't know about you, but I had a chain gun going. I don't know.
Yeah. In retrospect, I felt like I was defending MGTOW a little bit. Really, that wasn't my intention. I don't care for the movement. It's great. It's got some interesting people in it, but it was hijacked. It belongs to the extremists now. Basically. It was a nice movement that was waiting to be taken over, really.
Right.
You know, like feminism, had honest intentions, fair and noble-minded, but it got taken over, and, you know, the people who want the change aren't really stepping up to fight those who are taking it over. And it's sad. But, you know, if I had to say so, that's people who simply don't care enough. The feminists who got what they want, you know, don't want to rock the boat, so to speak. You know, they're not going to fight that. And, you know, the MGTOWs, they can probably talk a good game. I'm not convinced, but they can convince anybody else who doesn't really have the critical thinking skills necessary to sit there and say, hey, wait a second, I don't agree with what you're saying, or I need to think about it. You know, they can talk pretty peppy and rope, you know, pull a rope-a-dope on people.
Right.
So, I would more or less identify with the mass, if I had to. I don't care for cheap labels, but the neo-masculinity movement, which is, you know, largely self-development and then the return to, you know, a return to the roots. You know, this new world's a little messed up, and, you know, I think it would help if we kind of took a step back, almost literally, for society. That, or if we keep going forward, I don't think it'll work out. Now, we're going to see more movements show up, and they're going to be, they're not going to have any merit, but they're going to be around. So, other than that, no, I'm pretty sure that's a dead horse that got beat to hell with a stick.
Beat it! Beat it like you beat your dick. Alright, so. We can move on then. Because that's dead. So. Now.
Let's see, what do you want to... What can we
go? Politics. Let's... Going to politics. I know. So, the way it's turning out right now, and you know they say, never, never, never talk politics with a friend you plan to keep. So this will be fun.
Mm-hmm.
Right, recently...
I'll guide the conversation,
okay.
I'll just kind of answer.
So, excuse me, I have a face full of... pizza rolls. Recently, the two front runners for both parties are kind of starting to take shape here. Because we're starting to see that we have Hillary, who's probably going to end up as front runner for the Democratic side. And we have Trump, who's probably going to end up as the front runner for the Republican side. So let's start with this.
Okay.
Who do you support? And this is not, this question is not restricted to Hillary or Trump. This is an open-ended question.
Okay. Well, I like Trump. All right, I'll put that out there. I don't agree with everything he says, but I like Trump. I like that he's willing to buck the system, get things done. And, you know, he's got everybody hating him, so he's got to be doing something right. But... I do like some of his arguments. Everybody's complaining, oh, he hasn't explained how he's going to go about it. In fact, he has. He hasn't explained it in in one of the speeches he's had. But he has this website that is run by him for his campaign that explains how he's going to go about it. So everybody's like, how are you going to go and make Mexico build the wall? You never explained that. Well, on his website, as I saw, he wanted to throttle trade with Mexico. And in fact, one guy brought up an article where Mexico is so afraid of Trump right now, they're sending their best diplomat to try and propagandize Mexico so people begin to fight Trump instead of, you know, supporting him.
Okay. Now, what is this site, if you know it offhand?
I'm going to try and find it. You want his site or the site that found the article about the Mexican diplomat?
How about both?
Okay, so, well, there's DonaldJTrump.com.
And that is his site?
Mm-hmm. And under his position, you go to immigration reform. And it has it all there. It has all his positions right there. In fact, there's one right up at the top, pay for the wall. How do you make him pay for the wall?
Right, okay.
So there's that. I won't ramble off that. And let me see if I can find the other one. If I can say find it. He had it up. I'm going to look. But there is one where article about the Mexican diplomat. Yes, the United States Ambassador to Mexico.
Is that what you Googled?
No, that's not the right. I'm looking for him. It was the Ambassador to Mexico. What the fuck? Well, this guy, in his article that they interviewed him, he openly said he's going to lobby and perform a PR and media campaign in an attempt to sway the people into believing what they want. He didn't say it was going to be merited on facts. He wasn't going to present any sort of evidence that would disprove him. He's just going to lobby and present a media propaganda campaign that is going to attempt to sway people against the negative thoughts against Mexico. So rather than proving that Mexico's not, or proving Mexico's good, they're going to just say it and hope you believe it. Hope you, me, and everybody else believe it. I just need the fucker's name. The Mexican consul, that's who he is.
Okay.
Now, why the hell can't I find it? Anyways, alright, well, let's push it forward. I believe Trump has his merit because he's got people in a ruckus, and people don't like him because he's not willing to conform. And since he's self-funding his own campaign, have any of the big money people here.
Right, no lobbyists.
Trying to convince.
Indeed.
So, at least, even at a glance, or if you look into it, he at least can then, you know, go to what the people want versus listening to the big money, and he can actually do what the people want versus not doing it. And so it definitely warrants my attention and respect.
And you know, I actually agree with you so far.
So Hillary, hell no. Just I don't think there's really any other way to put it. Yeah, she's a woman. Yeah, she has experience, but with the crap she's pulled, it is a war crime that I equivocate to Edward Snowden. In fact, hers actually resulted in the deaths of people. Her mishandling of, you know, state secrets that resulted, which they didn't say it resulted, but it may have possibly assisted in the Benghazi attacks that resulted in the deaths of those four people.
There's something I disagree with you on. I disagree that Edward Snowden would. I wouldn't call what Edward Snowden war crimes.
Right. No, I'm equivocating it by their standard.
Right.
See, they say he committed a war crime because he released secrets that put people's lives in danger. That was the biggest thing, is that he put people's lives in danger. But Hillary did something similar, and by their own standard, and if they're finding evidence and they're still investigating it, may have potentially led to the deaths of those people. But
right.
She's not being, she hasn't been declared a traitor and exiled from her own country. She's in fact been praised for it by some people.
Right. Well, she's also pulled some pretty shady shit, too. A lot of shady shit. Regarding the whole email situation and, you know, stuff like that.
Right. So when I equivocated to Edward Snowden, I'm merely using him as the standard because, you know, he released this information for the good of the people and got declared a traitor. Hillary Clinton released the information, well, mishandled information, didn't give a shit what happened, and people died because of it. What's the fucking difference? Where's the line that's been crossed?
Right.
Why does that guy, you know, now have to fear and likely never come back to the U.S., and this other lady who's willing to put people in danger because she's incompetent, not get tried or, you know, have to take any form of responsibility?
You're all about that responsibility, aren't you, Wilkie?
I would have to say so, yeah.
You are.
You know, claim your shit. You screw up, claim it. You succeed, claim it. But too many people are willing to screw each other over, and it sucks. I'm still looking for this consulate, and I cannot find him. I see me. So... anyway, at least at a glance for me, and we could always push it further, I like Trump. I think he's definitely going to be a force for change, but now it's going to be, is that change going to be good or bad?
Right. I think either way I want to see what he's got. I'm willing to take the chance that his change will be good. Because I agree with enough of what he says to be willing to give him a chance, you know what I mean?
Yeah, I mean, that's what everything is, really. Everything's taking a chance and hoping it works out here. That's what movements are centered around, that's what, you know, entire campaigns are centered around. But, you know, Trump is probably the first presidential candidate to not have any donations beyond, like, people's personal donations. So, almost entirely self-funded. No big money, and it's funny because Ted Cruz, who thankfully came, you know, in this case, thank God, he ain't there because he lied. He already lied and said, I didn't take no donation from Goldman Sachs, and then when they went back and did a double check on his paper, oh, look at that, you got a $250,000 donation from, oh, look at that, Goldman Sachs. And he hasn't responded to that.
Naturally.
He's actually been saying, like, it's like you're looking at, that's not Goldman Sachs, I said Gold Nut Sachs, not Goldman Sachs, you know, some shit like that. No, he isn't even bothered, he knows he's screwed. The fucking piece of shit. Cruz is just, he's not even trustworthy. I don't even know how he got in for the campaign.
Oh, definitely.
It's funny, because, they had issues working on his tax papers. And his were only like 100 pages long or something like that. Donald Trump's has like a 500 pages long set of tax papers that he had to submit, and his is in order. Like, they haven't had a single issue with his, and they're like, Trump needs to release his taxes. Oh, fuck you. And that's my response. Well, how's the guy who has a...
multi-billion dollar company. Yeah.
You know, he's just got so much shit, and all his is in order, but the people who do their own fucking taxes don't got nothing in order. And these are people who technically did it for a living, because both Rubio and Cruz were lawyers.
Well, lawyers and accountants aren't the same thing, to be fair.
Well, Cruz ran his own business, and he worked for an office, and I believe he ran his own. So he took care of that on his own, and Rubio, he was doing constant trade deals between his homes and... He actually, I don't even know how the fuck he's not in jail right now, but he's been caught getting backroom deals and such through businesses for trading his homes and whatnot, and all that has to show up on your tax reports.
Right.
Because he's owned like three homes that were valued at like over $1.5 million, something close to that, in about a time period of about 7 to 10 years. And he was only making like $150,000 working for the firms he was at. So, and they got records of it. There's backroom dealings. He's actually openly stated he's fucking people because he was from Florida and he's the head. He was CIA or something like that, and he's been caught, and it's like, how the fuck are you not in jail? So, for these people who are supposedly have experience, their stuff's messed up, and Trump, whether he does it himself or pays somebody, his shit's in order. They haven't had a single issue. Not even saying, not even like a typo.
Right.
Okay, you misspelled that. No, nothing like that. So, nope. They're running out of ammunition to hit him with. But
this is the thing.
I love Trump.
And I don't know if you've heard about this, but he keeps coming up with nicknames for his opponents that are apparently proving to be significantly fatal toward his opponents' campaigns.
I heard a couple of them, like Lion Ted Cruz, or what the hell? I
think yeah.
Marco Rubio, Little Marky, or some shit like that. Yeah, I've seen it. I didn't know it had that effect on his campaign, you know, though, if it's a catchy nickname, it's a catchy nickname. I don't care what it is or why he said it. If it's catchy, it's good. So, I like Trump. I don't hate the guy. Dude built a success, and if he can at least try and make it so people can almost imitate him and, you know, be met with some success and make the system so at least the way people want it, I'm okay with that. Because really, that's why we elect him, is to do what we want, what the people want. And now they're threatening to steal the election from him. These superdelegates are being bought off. They're throwing every trick in the book they can, pulling every trick in the book, and doing everything they can to throw Trump off the trail. And I almost kind of agree with him. Like, if they steal the election from him and he doesn't wind up the nominee, I'm pretty sure some people are going to be pissed if not outright riot. I don't know about the riots, but in a way, I kind of hope that would turn out, because then it's like, you know, you fucked up. People you beat up on are coming to kick the shit out of you. So, yeah, I'm for Trump, and I hope he does wind up the nominee, and in a way, I hope unless some other candidate steps up, I hope he wins. Shut down.
Good shit.
I mean, unless we want to start talking policy, which, like I said, that's all up, and, you know, he has his plans on paper, so these people saying he's not talking about it, simply he's not wasting time at the fucking debates. He's got it written down instead, read it.
Right, you said on his website, Donald J. Trump.
Mm-hmm.
.biz.co.com/RU.
Yep. For a guy who's accused of being Hitler, he's got his shit in order. And I don't have any moral issues with him.
Well, you know, Hitler was a morally interesting kind of guy.
Yeah, I believe he said he was Catholic, and I believe they had proof at, you know, shortly before he started the invasion of probably several years before when he came to power, he actually got the blessing of the Pope to do it. He may have excommunicated it, but he got the blessing of the Pope, and he claimed he was doing God's work when he was killing the Jews, so morally speaking, like, I don't know, that's... I'm certain a lot of Catholics aren't happy about it.
Sure, a lot of Catholics choose not to to remember that part.
Oh dear. So, but yeah, Trump for the win. Although, I won't be able to vote until November, because, you know, I'm a registered independent.
Yeah, me too. Kinda shitty.
Yeah, fuckers. Anyways, yes, I hope he gets a nomination. He winds up our president by February next year. February or whenever they do the inauguration. And then I hope, probably my biggest doubt about him is that will he keep his word, or will he, you know, at least do his best? That's all I would expect, is to do his best to stand by his word, stand by what he says. If he says he's gonna make Mexico pay for the fucking wall, I hope he do it. Not because I would hope, you know, such a situation occurs in the future, but because he's gonna keep his fucking word. Because really, that's all we could ever ask of our president. Well, two things. Honesty and try your hardest. You got game.
Yeah. I got fucking I can't play support, man. I'm terrible at support. Getting my ass handed to me.
Well, alright. Go politics. Now it's just kind of like a lazy, lousy conversation.
Oh yeah, naturally.
We must entertain the audience.
They're all looking for blood sport. We're about to start losing the subscribers.
Mm-hmm. Bernie, all I can say with Bernie is like, feel the burn, suck a cock. Vote for Bernie.
Vote for Bernie.
Yeah, if you ever remember Mr. Medicare. I like him. He gets some interesting conversations with him. He was originally known as an internet aristocrat, and he was kind of, I guess he's a centerpiece of the Gamergate movement.
Right, right.
Which I don't still fully understand what Gamergate was. I know it was like this big hubbub about ethics and journalism over some girl who slept with five guys to get her game out, and it wound up turning into this, like, a weapon of feminism and anti-feminism. Like, there's two sides, and it's what the hell is going on? No, it's very hard to pin down where it started and what to do. So it was strange to me, and I still don't fully understand it.
I don't know. Gamersgate. Gamersgate was more about the fact that a girl was, what do you call it? She was the manager of the community manager of a game that she did not know enough about. Oh.
Well, I know, this is what I know, I'll just admit it. So, it started with Zoe Quinn. Alright, so she created this game. She was an independent game developer on her own. Created this game called Depression Quest. And it, you know, and the arguments that she didn't trust it enough to stand on its own merit and to, you know, be good as a game. Instead, she, you know, she knew the guys, she was dating guys, and slept around to get these guys to write about her game, publicity, to get people, and openly encourage people to buy it. So now there's the ethics issue, because these journalists were motivated by vagina to, you know, basically write what that girl wanted to try and sell her game. So there's a conflict of interest, and it brought to surface more issues where people were found to be supporting each other by donating money and encouraging each other, which, while it isn't bad, it's conflict of interest. The issue is that you've got people supporting each other and not openly disclosing it. So, Zoe Quinn got shit for basically being a whore, and the feminist movement stepped in with, like, Anita Sarkeesian kind of leading it. Or at least she's at the forefront screaming the loudest. Saying that it's misogyny to hate a woman, even though it's misconstruing the argument, saying, no, we're not mad that she slept around, we're mad that she slept around to sell something, and creating this conflict of interest, and they're mad that the journalists were involved, these people who are supposed to, you know, have integrity and honesty, threw that away a little bit of vagina. So it's one big mess. One big mess. That's it. That's all I can say about it. One big mess. And I just never understood, because there was so many arguments in one. And to me, it was stupid and didn't really warrant my fucking attention. So, yeah, I had issues with it, and it was just interesting because it got so big and involved so many people.
No, Gamersgate is about gaming media. Has nothing to do with the lady who got her game in. Many gaming media outlets have gone to shit over the years. This is off of an explanation from a user on Reddit, who back at the time would know more than what we know. Okay. When we discovered that something fishy was going on through less than ideal means of settlements, we investigated further and found wholesale deception, undisclosed advertisements, and a heap of unethical or biased journalism. So Gamersgate is about biased journalism, and hold on.
Of course.
And this off the Wikipedia centers on the harassment campaign conducted primarily through the use of Twitter hashtag Gamersgate around the issues of sexism, progressivism, and video game culture. It's used as a blanket term for the controversy, the harassment campaign, and the actions of those participating in it, and the loosely organized movement that emerged from the hashtag. I gotta change the thing before I finish reading it. Hold on.
Right. Rather than starting it, it was just a part of it.
Right.
Part of it.
Beginning in August 2014, they targeted women in the video game industry, including game developer Zoe Quinn and Brianna Wu, and cultural critic Anita Sarkeesian. After a former boyfriend of Quinn wrote a lengthy, disparaging blog post about her, I have to take care of the stream here. I'll read it again in a minute. After a former boyfriend wrote a disparaging blog post about her, others falsely accusing her of entering a relationship with a journalist in exchange for positive coverage and threatening her with assault and murder. Those endorsing the blog post and spreading such accusations against Quinn organized themselves under the Twitter hashtag Gamersgate. So that's what started it. Zoe Quinn started it, but was not the focus of it. She was a part of it.
Right. She came to the center when her shit was happening.
Right.
So, but no, she didn't. Okay. No, I just never understood. So I'm, you know, that.
Burn, motherfuckers.
Fucking hell, man, I keep inviting this guy. He ain't getting in. It's like, invite me, I invited him, and he's just kinda like, dicking around. Anyway, so, Gamersgate was more about the... And if anyone of you assholes who are watching and won't talk know how to better explain it to us, then please, by all means, do. It was about games journalism and people fucking about. We got 74 people watching now, and still no one's fucking talking.
Are we really that interesting, or is it just
me? I don't know. I don't know. Where do I want to be? Who have I not been?
and carnage. I bloom like a flower in the dawn.
Well, I guess you could argue that Gamergate is kind of what brought feminism back to the forefront. You know, before, it was kind of this silent thing that was happening, and nobody really cared too much.
Right.
But, you know, now that, you know, you have Anita Sarkeesian, who claims to be a prominent feminist, it kind of brought it back to the forefront. Now they're like, misogyny, men are women haters, and, you know, this bullshit about internalized misogyny. Like, oh, if you don't love your vagina, you hate it. You know, the us or them.
Right, right.
Blah, blah, blah. And it's like, wow. How about a magic? It's like, if you're not with us, you're against us, and crush them, motherfuckers. End them.
In carnage, I bloom like a flower in the dawn.
So, yeah, that's pretty much what that was about. That was about games journalism being downright shitty. Kind of like, you know, corrupt, in a way.
Yeah, I am. And really, the rules have already been set, so the fact that this shit was even happening is a testament to the issue.
What shit?
You know, ethics. People throwing out these rules that were meant to keep everybody honest and keep things fair. And, you know, how are you supposed to trust people if they're just going to throw away everything for, you know, just cheap shit, things that don't really mean. Yeah, you can always get vagina whether you earn it or pay for it or something like that, you know. You know, so to me it's just strange that they would sacrifice so much for so little. I don't know, it's just mind-boggling to me, because, you know, I'm kind of the risk without reward is bullshit, you know, you gotta get something if you're gonna operate that way. But these guys, you know, ethics in terms anyways, you know, having some integrity and honor, and then throwing it away for not.
Right.
You know, I mean, to me it's just mind-boggling, because is this how low we've come? Before, you fought for what was yours and what you wanted, you earned it, and now we're just turning on each other.
Naturally.
And then they look at, you know, guys like you and me, our generation, and the generation ahead of us and behind us, and they, alright, you gotta keep it going. No, we don't. I want no fucking part of it, in fact. Yeah. You know, and, you know, just so I can say it, that's why, you know, I don't really care for the fall of society, you know, because to me it's not really worth saving, because you got these people who don't care. Now, if we had something to offer and the people were, you know, actually had the honor and integrity they claim they do, I'd be far more invested in it. And even now though, I would say we do have something more to offer with our culture is basically better than the Islamic culture that's being played off as being so fucking peaceful, when how, you know, they say Islam is peaceful, but if it's peaceful, how come it's produced the largest amount of radicals?
Because it's so peaceful, Wilkie, you know. Logic. Come on, man.
That's video game logic bullshit.
Yeah, video games cause violence, you know.
Yeah, if video games cause violence, why aren't all these little kids out murdering each other because their parents let them play Grand Theft Auto? Why aren't they jumping in their parents' cars and running down hookers for money? You know, so if Islam's peaceful, how come there's so many radicals? How do I draw these fuckers out into the fire? There you go, fire on them bastards.
No! The lag! Of course, the lag excuses, man. Gotta love them.
Lag is good for you.
What doesn't lag you makes you stronger, man.
Is that what they say?
Yeah, that's what the kiddies say these days. Yoink.
My military is just so much better when I have boat archers instead of... It's strange. I have bow units on boats. I'm playing Total War Attila here. And bow units on boats, while having infinite ammo, also deal significantly more damage and get more kills per match than a couple full archer units that I recruited, actual land archers.
Right.
And, like, these guys just, they rip up ground units. That's why I draw them to the beach and I let the archers on the boats, which have the ability to replenish their ammo, so they can shoot indefinitely. And they wreck units, whereas the archers on the land suck. And the archers on the boats, there's only like 80 of them. On the land, you get 160 man unit. And the man unit does more damage over in a match ever compared to the fucking guys on the ground.
Right.
So I don't understand. But game logic.
Are they more expensive or something? Any reason to believe they'd be better trained?
About the only argument you got is that they're basically marines. You know, they're on boats. They're archers shooting from a boat. That's about it. And I mean, I got these boats beached, but they're firing off the boat, so they have the ammo.
I can
chase after the archer units because they got the skirmish on, but I can draw them to the beach and they come under fire. And my archers just shred their units. Like, per volley, they're killing anywhere from 3 to 5 guys, and I got 4 ships volleying them, so 20 guys dying per volley, and the volleys come off about every 3 to 5 seconds, so this unit's getting destroyed. And you only need to take about half of it before they commit to a rout. Like, right now, I just shredded a unit down to half, and it's running. Not to mention they have the fire arrows, which inflict morale damage. So they're running. They'll come back and they'll just get volleyed. So that, and I still have reserves left too. I won't land them though because the archers will shred them. If I get too many there, they'll just sit there and flay them. But I got these guys packed close to the beach. And the archers just smash them. There, volley. Killed 3 guys. 4 more volleys coming in. Another 10 dead people. And my melee troops, which are also more efficient than standard land troops unless I'm facing heavy infantry, do more killing. And I wish they'd send their general force so I could kill them and start a chain route and then I could win. And when I started this battle, I said I had like a 10% chance to win, but I know how powerful my archers are, so I just sit there and kite the piss out of them.
Oh yeah, now Warwick's coming. Motherfuck. Fucking Warwick.
Now the chain route's gonna start. Because I'm smashing them on the beach, and they're gonna just start running.
Son of a bitch. You fucking slut.
Anyways, we kind of quit talking about politics. I don't know if you want to, like, kill the stream or something, because... Maybe, maybe not. I don't know. Most people want to sit here and talk and watch us listen to talk about games.
No, I mean, I'd imagine that people wouldn't be too bad. I don't imagine a lot of people care what it is. We, believe it or not, we've actually gone up in viewers, so... And all we've been doing is bitching now.
That's what we're good at, damn it.
Being assholes, yeah.
Well, these guys ain't coming anymore. They're just sitting there, but still sniping. Another one goes down. Come on, you fuckers, come after me.
Holy shit, I'm not doing too well here. I'm like 0-5 this match. Bot lane in general isn't my thing. Other than that, I'm losing my touch for today. Too many league games back to back.
Maybe. Better in that position?
You'd have a manual reload button for some of these champions, man. There's my fucking ult.
There, you can start a chain around. Get him running.
Waited up forever for you. Well, what? One guy's talking a little bit. Warwick won't fucking real salty right now. Almost funny. this is one of those instances I was telling you about where the problem with League is the fact that the one person on the team don't know how to shut his fucking mouth. Running into that kind of scenario, you know? Shit. Fuck. That's someone. That's what I wanted to get into. I wanted to start playing a little bit at Udyr and see if I could do anything fun. I almost forgot about that till I just saw a Udyr. Oh no, get him! Get him! Get him, get him! Yoink! Okay. So difficult. It's really kind of you guys. Keep it up. No, I don't shoutcast. No, I'm not pro. Fuck you. Yeah, you know, I just signed on with, Faker, you know, or with Samsung White, because I'm Korean, and you know, it's gonna be great. It really is. Shit, man. Alright, I reckon it's about time to kill it.
Yeah, we ran out of shit to talk about.
So. Unfortunately. Well, I guess that about cuts it out for today. We'll have to, in the future, kind of structure it a little bit better. That way we either A, don't run out of things to talk about, or B, have, you know when to cut it.
Yeah. About an hour is usually good.
Yeah, I would say. Maybe an hour per additional person. So, like, per person, 1 hour. If we have, like, two people, you know, half an hour, three people, 2 hours. Because at least then it drives conversation a little bit more, you know, like when we have Andrew around.
Right. So, I gotta piss up your back.
Yep, I'll catch you later. And as for you, stream, stay frosty.